This business has a history that's way before all of us. There's carriages running around Central Park for 160 years, but no one ever tried to ban this business. His name is Steven Nislik, and he owns lots of properties on the west side. He owns, you can see some of the properties from here that he owns. Right down there is a Manhattan mini storage building. He says he's a great animal activist, but he does a thing with horses out in the country called eventing, and it's terribly demanding on a horse. All the horses have a lot of problems that are in that deal, and I wouldn't do it to a horse. It's a real high performance skill where the horses often get hurt, and they have to have veterinarians and even horse ambulances on call when they have these events. But his motivation to the public is he has grabbed a hold of these animal activists. A lot of them are a little bit offbeat, but they are sincere. And he's found an opportunity to be able to use them to his advantage. He sets up a wonderful screen in front of his true intentions. Christine Quinn was pro-carriage. Yeah, she was a good friend. She listened to us. She didn't go become pro-carriage overnight. We had to talk to her and let her understand our position, and she came more and more to support us as we explained ourselves more thoroughly. On the merits, we always seemed to win, but she looked like the obvious next mayor of New York City, too. Nislik thought he had her in his grasp so well that he had a fundraiser for her in which he gave her something like $25,000. And then after that, they had a party, an after party, and he bragged about how he had Quinn in his control and in his charge, and he used the words like, she's now drank the Kool-Aid and we have her, she's ours. But he made the mistake that one of the people in the carriage business was at that restaurant that night and taped everything that he said. And then that was presented to Christine Quinn, and she read it, and it was presented to the New York Post, and then it was published in the papers, and it showed you the intention of Nislik, that what he made statements like, if you we'll support you, but if you don't work with us, we'll hurt you. So with a few things like that, and he also mentioned that he would euthanize these horses, perhaps in that statement, it's on, in his own words. When Christine Quinn read that article in the paper, and then when she listened to the tapes that were presented with his voice, she said, I'm returning this money to him. I can't take this money. I can take money and from somebody who supports my candidacy, and I'll listen to their points of view, but I can't accept this. This is more like a bribe than a campaign contribution. So she refused it, and she gave the money back, about $25,000. He then abandoned her and started his campaign, Anybody But Quinn. Steve Nislik formed New York Class, and he formed that group with one intention, and that was to get rid of the horse carriages. Not for any other purpose was that formed. And then he was very adept at going over to the ASPCA and cozying up with the president of the ASPCA, a guy named Ed Sayers. And with Ed Sayers, and I don't know if this involved the board of directors of the ASPCA also, but they were able to take that something like $700,000 and transfer it from the ASPCA, who are what you call a 501c3, and they are not allowed to do campaign contributions, but they were allowed to take their money and send it over to Nislik's group, New York Class, which is a 501c4. And then he took that money, the $700,000 or so, and campaigned in the politics of this election with the ASPCA's money to the tune of about $700,000. That was his goal, to make us look so bad so that we would be diverted off the true issue, which is his interest in this real estate. He wanted everything to, it's almost like you, I love the horses, but it's almost like you fall into a trap when you just keep talking about the horses and how they're happy and they're well cared for, because it's an unending argument. And he loves that type of a conversation to take place, because it takes you away from his true goal, and that's for you to lose your properties here, your properties to become valueless to you. It's not a good answer. I can't give you a good answer. It's a dire answer. The horses, 85-90% of them will end up in some foreign country on somebody's plate. And the drivers won't be able to do much about that. They'll have to liquidate their horses and sell them off, because they'll be too busy worrying about their families. They just won't be able to hold on to their livestock. Some horses you'll be able to find a home for, but the vast majority are not going to have a future at all. Because these horses, as I say, they're not horses that are suitable for heavy-duty farm work anymore. They're older horses. Like the Amish like a horse to be about 5 to 10 years of age. And we want a horse when he's about 12 to 16 years of age. This is altogether different. The Amish guy might take his horse and put him in his buggy and drive him pretty fast down the road 10 miles. We put him in our buggy and the same horse when he's a little bit older, and we ask him to walk. We want the ride to be as slow as possible. So it's not demanding on the horse. And by the way, they do strengthen when you only walk them instead of running them. The human explanation is here, I could walk around that block 40 times, I guess, today if I wanted to, but I couldn't run around twice, you know? And that's what is asked of these horses, really low performance. Yeah.